by engagement, building emotional connections from acquisition to increase in repeat value creation. The idea at the end of the day for each one of you is to retain your customers, and they always want high quality service, value for money, and certainly want to see that they're given respect on a regular basis in return for their loyalty. But increasingly, customers are becoming more demanding. They're expecting far more timely, appropriate, personalized, and consistent communication. And they want this from their favorite brands. For their favorite brands, it's important that they stay that way. So these demands are driving traditional loyalty and its engagement with top brands. They're also taking loyalty programs to a brand new level, allowing for experimentation and ensuring that customer communication channels are getting more and more innovative. The masterclass with Gordon, with Alistair Gordon, is going to be one that's been tailor-made to show you how to find and deliver the oomph factor, the wow factor to your customer engagement activities, both in food retail and food service segments. It'll also give attendees the stepping stone to significantly enhance your customer engagement programs to drive incremental value and revenue while finding the perfect balance between complexity, operation, and of course, cost. So without much ado, let me welcome Alistair Gordon, who's the founder and MD Value Access. Not only is he the founder of this company, but he of course has got a very, very significant clout, because they have been a provider of gift card and customer engagement programs to more than 100 major brands across Asia. They're based out of Hong Kong since 1996, and Alistair has previously established and operated companies in Asia, UK, and the US, being in touch with the customer, delivering spectacular consumer services. For the last 6 years, Alistair has been a judge for prepaid and emerging payments awards, and some of his clients, Pacific Coffee, City Super, Outback, SSP, Pizza Hut, and the list goes on. Plenty of reasons for you to be here in the conference hall to listen to Alistair Gordon. Ladies and gentlemen, in the conference room, now kicking off the masterclass.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, oh, perfect, now it's working. For those of you that are back from lunch, thank you very much. Always the worst spot of the day. I've been asked to go quite quickly because we've obviously a little bit behind. What I want to do is give you a little bit on customer engagement. The last time I did a masterclass, I think it was 3 hours long, so I'm gonna have to race through one or two just key messages. What I'm gonna try and drive into today is how this world of data and how what used to be called loyalty is changing into customer engagement, but most importantly, in a context of the level and sophistication and drive of customers, consumers, modern retail and operations in India. How do you manage this process? We all see the Holy Grail a long way away as fantastic amount of data and what to do with it and how to do it. But realistically, in retail today, can we cope with that? And how do we find a path that's starting at a less sophisticated level into the world that we want to get into? It's easy to read an article that says I'm going to analyze bucket loads of data and deal with my customers on a personal basis. It's an awful lot harder to actually do that from time, cost, resource basis. So what is the path on the way there? Just a very brief word about Value Access and what we do and what we've been doing. It was a very good introduction. Thank you very much. We're operating in Hong Kong, China, India, a few other small other countries in a slightly smaller way, 100 plus brands. We're loading $76 million worth a year and operating in those six countries. I have three areas of operation, and I'm going to talk about all of them today. The first one is straightforward gift card, branded prepaid card programs. Sole purpose, customer acquisition. It's the first piece of customer engagement is driving into that acquisition process. The second piece of that is how I take those gift cards outside of a issuing store and bring them into and expand reach. And I'll talk a little bit about that, but I'll concentrate most on the next piece of customer acquisition or customer engagement, and that is driving into getting people back, getting people spending more money, and ultimately it's about the revenue. This slide won't come as a surprise to anybody in the food service business, anybody in the F&B business. Ultimately, your world is about incremental revenue. And how do you drive that incremental revenue? More transactions, more customers, more money per transaction. And the task for the engagement process is how do we deal and how do we influence customers to do what we want them to do? Influence customers to come in more, acquire new customers, bring their friends, introduce customers to spend more money, come more frequently. Those levers are the same whether you're a supermarket, whether you're a restaurant. But the world of customer engagement has changed very, very rapidly over the last few years. We're beginning to see some real trends, blindingly obviously, in virtualization, digitization, personalization, people wanting to be noticed as an individual, obviously communication, mobility. All of these trends are driving a world where no longer is your customer engagement simply about you being out in the market, doing marketing, advertising, and hoping that the customer comes along. It's now much more opportunity about how does that customer interact with you, and how does that customer want to interact with you. All of us as consumers have different views of the channel through which I would like to communicate with the brands that I like. Some of us old boys are probably still in a card. People are moving obviously away from cards as the identifier. Some of us old boys don't really want to be communicated to. Clearly, younger consumers have absolutely no issue of communicating almost permanently with you as a brand. And there's an awful lot of opportunity for them to do that, where actually they can send you messages rather than just you sending them messages in the old traditional media sense. So interactivity with your consumers is what's driving this new world of customer engagement. From a building point of view of how do we start to actually create a program that is changing and moving with the times, we start over here, if you can see that, the traditional data capture. The first thing you need is data. In some worlds, it's easy. Personal data, we've been doing that for ages. How old are you? Where do you live? Are you male, female? Everything else. Transaction data, again, that's been going on for ages. How much are you spending? How many times are you visiting? Even getting more sophisticated a little bit into when are you coming? And slowly but surely, also made that step into what products are you buying? If I'm in a coffee chain, if I'm buying only drinks, can I buy food? If I only come for food, can I buy drinks? It's a simple world, but if I come for a cup of coffee and you get me to buy a donut, that is driving incremental revenue. The new piece in all of this is this interaction data. How do I start to drive into some of those new communication channels, such as social media, and what does that do for me? There's new types of values that are being created for brands. And if you think of an old-fashioned loyalty program, loyalty programs, customer engagement, have been about delivering value for brands. And people spending money, that's what we've rewarded. But in today's world, somebody in the social media world is providing value. If they're sitting there on Facebook going, Pizza Hut's the best restaurant I've ever been to, then that is creating value for your brand. So how do you start to look to reward them? How do you bring in some of that data to analyze it so that you can reward that behavior? It's starting to open and change the game. Similarly, when we start to look at different programs, as an ex-military individual, the first thing we ever used to do in the Army way back when I was a young lad, was talk about the objective. Different program constructs are being driven by what are you trying to achieve. As I've looked at retail over the last 4 or 5 years in India, where I've been coming backwards and forwards, one of the things that clearly it's been about customer acquisition. Times have changed a little bit. It's not just all about building as fast as people can go, but it's now beginning to be a little bit more about how do I actually create real value in each store, in each restaurant that I have, and from each consumer. So we're starting to move up the channel from just getting customers into the program into making sure that we reward them properly and ultimately making sure that we've actually got an understanding of who they are so that we're targeting them properly. Now, targeting them properly is not just he's a gold, silver, bronze type of member. Targeting them properly is making sure that we understand whether he's a high spender, high frequency, what are the levers in my business. It's starting to understand how I actually segment those groups so that I can manage my process of engagement. Okay, we cannot live in a world where we talk individually to every single customer. But we must identify the groups that we can talk to in a coherent fashion. And it's also starting to understand that I prefer to talk to you through a social media environment versus my dad would rather speak to you in email. Clearly, the world of devices and communication has changed. How do I identify you in the program? And on the right-hand side, how do we start to use some of that data? The first piece is how do I manage the program, but then how do I take it up a step? The good old-fashioned reporting has now changed into the world of business intelligence and analytics, and how can I extract those insights so that I can drive the influence that I want to do? And we're going to have a very quick look at some of that as we go through. So, starting with the first challenge for you in acquisition. How do I get people into my store? And the second part of acquisition is how do I get people into a program? Loyalty, customer engagement, CRM, whatever you choose to call it, hinges around an ability to create a communication channel with that person, which unfortunately never gets away from the dirty business of getting them to register one way and another. The first piece on simple acquisition, getting through the door without any names or details, is the world of a gift card. Whether this is issued by companies to their staff as rewards incentive, friends to friends, etc., etc., a gift card with value in somebody's pocket that's branded to your store is driving them into the store. Whoever receives it, and it doesn't matter where it comes from, if I've got 500 rupees to go and spend in Pizza Hut, then I'm going to go into Pizza Hut and have dinner. And that's all it does, simple customer acquisition. When I get there, I spend more, but pretty typically, having been there the first time, I come back. Largely because the first time I went there, it was a good experience, and some of what I was spending was free. Now, that 500 rupee card has probably driven a 750 rupee spend. It's acquired the customer. There's one key change to this world of gift cards that's happening very, very rapidly at the moment in India, and that's this piece here. Companies using gift cards has gone on for a lot of time. There's a long time here. There's a lot of paper vouchers that have been issued and everything else. What's changing is the world from paper into digital world. How does that company now deliver that digital capability so that I can get that money into somebody's pocket? A lot of the rewards and recognition companies have changed completely into a world where they don't want to deliver paper. The logistic cost is too high. They don't want to deliver plastic cards. The logistic cost is too high. It's much, much easier just to deliver an email. The challenge is, in your restaurant, in your stores, can you actually redeem that email? Operationally, it's much harder to redeem it and manage the operation than it is to send it out. Sending it out is easy. The second piece of the change in the gift card world is as we've moved into electronic transaction, it allows us to start the distribution business. So I take a Pizza Hut card and push it into Apollo Pharmacy. I take a Pizza Hut card and I push it into a Big Bazaar. Okay, the sorts of footfalls in a Big Bazaar, you're taking whatever the latest number is of Pizza Hut types of outlets, call it 330, 350, and I'm giving them access to that enormous footprint. It is expanding its reach and driving acquisition out to in for the restaurant chain, for the supermarket. Clearly, where we're looking to install the distribution is in high footfall retail chains, the supermarkets, the hypermarkets, and everything else. It is a very dominant category. For those guys, very high margins and revenue per square foot because, of course, it's so small a product. From an F&B point of view, consumers love receiving restaurant gift cards. It's easy. I go into the store and spend in the restaurant. Okay, it's encouraging me to go there. Okay, very, very popular. And of course, the bottom statistic here, the size and scale of this stuff is just staggering. The float that Starbucks is sitting on in the US is just enormous. Very nice for their business to have that upfront cash. So there's a world of gift cards that are starting to drive into member acquisition. So in the world of member acquisition, if a company or a friend gives a consumer a gift card to a specific brand, that is the person who knows that consumer identifying that the consumer has an affinity with the brand. So anybody who receives a gift card is automatically being identified by the people that know him as somebody who has affinity to the brand. He is a prime suspect to join into the engagement program for that brand. Okay, so it's one of the simplest ways into a loyalty program. Clearly, your top fans and customers that come all of the time will be in your store and will sign up for new programs. But anybody that's been given a gift card to you is somebody who can migrate. As soon as he has a gift card, he has an identity in the store, a way that we can identify him, and so you automatically move him into a loyalty CRM type of program. We run this business with Pacific Coffee in Hong Kong, where they have both gift cards and a loyalty program, and we move one across to the other. So as soon as somebody comes into the store and starts trying to use their gift card, they're automatically replaced with a loyalty card, and we drive them into using that loyalty program so that we can start to try and bring them back. The other way that we start to look at customer acquisition, and it's just an example of one of the many ways that we do this. The challenge in any membership program, loyalty program, engagement program, is to build that customer communication channel, which means I need to be able to identify you and have one way or other of getting to you, and a way that you like, whether it's by phone and SMS, whether it's by email, whether it's through social media. So again, simple way that we got people to sign up into the KFC program in Hong Kong. On their website, all it does is it gives you an opportunity to click through and in Facebook, click through and join the program. If you click through, you are automatically asked whether you can export your mobile phone number from your Facebook data across to KFC. Assuming that you say yes, you will immediately receive an SMS. Okay, that offers you 5 different coupons to be redeemed through the delivery channel. Okay, so as they're advertising it to sign up to my program, they're telling you that if you join my program, you're getting 5 freebies. Once I receive my SMS, you're in the program. I can identify you because when you phone in to the call center, I'm identifying your mobile number, you're already registered in the program, I've got an ability to communicate with you, and as you then make your order at the call center, the call center is looking at, being popped onto their screen, the coupons that you've got being offered to you. So I've incentivized you to join, I've made it incredibly easy for you to click through and join the program, I've opened up the communication channel, and I've got you using those coupons to add an extra product, service, drink, whatever it is, into that program. You now get your food and you're happy. What we've actually also done, just out of interest here, for KFC, is we're doing product testing, because the 5 coupons are all new products. So as they're working out who's accepting and using which coupons as they're ordering, they're beginning to identify the next special that's going to be 2-3 months hence across the chain of stores. So there's a number of different levels to this in a very slick, easy, consumer-friendly way to get a relationship that is interactive and has those communication rails with the consumer. In the world of, good old world of loyalty, this is how we lived. We lived in a world that simply we got some transaction data and based upon that we did automatic rating. And you got a prize. You spent $100, we gave you 10 points. Okay? You spent $100, we gave you 10 extra dollars to spend next time you came into the store. Okay? All of which had a value. Okay? It's got a little bit more sophisticated over time as we've looked at starting to run some rating, some automated activity to work out what other prizes are you having. So, for example, not just how much you're spending, but how many times in a month, in a quarter, in the year have you come, and what do we do with you as a result? Equally, the prizes have got a little bit more sophisticated, gone from just points, but how do we start to use couponing to try and incentivize you, influence you, reward you, everything else. So now, rather than giving you 10 points, can I give you a free coffee, free piece of cake, this type of activity? The one thing I'll just mention in passing is status. I've lived, I think, most of my life in Asia, so I feel fairly Asian as I go through, but status is an enormous driver in loyalty. I want to be seen to be important. It's actually much more important to many people than getting a free piece of cake. If you can acknowledge me in the store and make sure that everybody can see how important I am to you, that really is a big driver for my ongoing loyalty. So this is the world that we've lived in. And it's pretty easy, it's just data, something goes through, a transaction happens, and we run the technology to turn around and say, have a prize. As you start to take this type of activity to the next level, surprise and delight is the key phrase of loyalty. How can I give you something that you don't know you're going to get? Make sure you feel comfortable, make sure you feel warm and fuzzy. So we start to look at a little bit more sophisticated rating. So in this case, with Pacific Coffee, for example, the consumer saw nothing of this program. We launched the program in complete secret, and on the 10th day, which you had, or the 10th visit that you made after we launched the program, and you've no clue that the program is going on, suddenly the staff at the cash desk turns around and says, oh, Alistair, would you like a free piece of cake with that coffee? It is a complete surprise for you, and of course you delight. It goes straight into status too, because everybody standing around you is going, wow, why is this guy being treated so well? And the program, oops, sorry, and the program goes on in exactly the same way. Consumer's not counting, the consumer doesn't work. Yeah, go for it. Yep.
But the consumer knew what is he getting on the 5th visit, on the 7th visit. So if McDonald's did this smile card thing where the consumer actually knew that on the 5th visit, 7th visit, what exactly is he or she supposed to get. So in that case, there was actually an active motivation on the customer's part to go for the 7th visit or the, you know, whatever I'm saying. In this case, how does the brand track that this was the 7th visit or the 10th coffee? I mean, and what makes the brand believe that the customer is going to do the 10th?
Yes, okay, so what I would say is that the normal program of Pacific Coffee is addressing that every 5th visit to McDonald's, you get a prize. Okay, so the normal program is every time you spend money, you earn points, and that's trying to drive your loyalty in the old-fashioned way of frequency, because you've got a stack of points that buys you free coffee. So this is not trying to be the routine activity of the program. Whereas the way that I understand your McDonald's smile activity, you've probably got 5 chops when you've gone in, and on the 6th chop, you hand it across and get a free burger. Okay. What this is doing is going above and beyond that normal routine. Okay. It's not happening all of the time. It's a promotion that we ran for a couple of months to try and get the people with high frequency. Okay, and as we'll look at them in a minute, as we look at some of the customer segmentation, some of those guys to actually feel warm and fuzzy about how much they're loved. Because what this drives is 2 things. One, it's nice to have a free piece of cake in the morning or donut or whatever it is. But as I'm standing in the queue getting my coffee, there are 5 people behind me queuing up. Now, I'm made to feel king of the world because I'm getting something that they're not. Okay, very important status position. Secondly, I feel very warm and fuzzy to the brand because they're giving me something that I didn't know. The people that are qualifying for this type of frequency are clearly the high spenders. Okay, because they're coming quite a lot, they're spending quite a lot, and everything else. So this is an absolute retention capability.
But the whole idea is that, let's say you had done 8 coffee.
Yeah.
You had done 8 visits and 8 coffees. So it would have been unfair, in my opinion, it would have been unfair to that customer that he didn't know that, you know, 2 more coffees and...
Okay, but the trick to this is, you're not telling anybody, okay? We don't tell anybody about this. All we're doing on the back end is we're collect, counting the number of visits that you do. And the moment that we see that you have a ninth visit, we release the coupon that comes into the store. Okay, so that the next time you come in, on the point of sale, that coupon is popping up saying, offer Alistair a free piece of cake. Okay, now you as a consumer don't know that you're getting that piece of cake because it's your 10th visit or your 20th visit or your 30th visit. You've just turned up one Tuesday morning and you get that piece of cake. So you don't know about the 10, 20, 30. You just turn up from time to time and somebody gives you extra. No, but again, there's two different things that you're trying to do. We're not, in this program, we're not trying to drive the normal loyalty program. In this program, we're targeting our top customers with a retention capability so that they feel the love. Okay, it's all emotion. We're just trying to make you feel really special. Okay, because the top customer is the guy that's coming 10, 20, 30 times in a month, comes every day, he's spending a lot of money. And you'll see them in a minute in the segmentation exercise, you know, how small a number this is, so, but how they're delivering the big revenue.
So, I mean, on the contrary, if he's anyways so habituated to come to the place daily, I mean, what's the point of giving him something on the 10th coffee? I mean, isn't it actually cannibalization of the, I mean, you're habituated because probably this cafe is situated near your house, office, and I mean, you had no other choice practically speaking because this happens to be the most logistically possible solution. So, I mean, if you are anyways addicted to it and you're coming 10 times, why do I need to, discount or give you a freebie?
Okay, again, this is about looking after my best customers. Different programs do different activities. Okay, my best customers in Hong Kong, we have Starbucks, equivalent number of stores. We have about 15 other coffee chain brands. All I'm looking to do is make sure that this guy doesn't go somewhere else. His revenue to me, it's very, very important to keep him. For a cost of a piece of cake, if I make him feel warm and fuzzy every 6 months, it's well worth it to me, given the amount that he's spending to me. It's a simple retention exercise. Make him feel good.
So in this particular case study, just how have you registered the customers who are coming to you, as in, did you went through the Facebook thing again, the click button, and
So the Pacific Coffee program runs completely differently. There's a complete normal process. So the way it works is you buy a card on which you load $200 Hong Kong, and you start spending that card. Okay, at that point, you're not registered. You're just spending money. It's convenience. You can pay and everything else. You then get forced to go to the Pacific Coffee website and register a whole load of information, much more than we would advise as it happens. Once you've done that, and this is the trick to the program, is that all of the points that you've earned from your initial spending are only released to you once you have registered. So in the store, as you come in and you're spending off your card, off the cash on your card, the store staff can see how many points you've got. So they can say to you, oh, that coffee would have been free if you've registered, and the points that you've got, you've now earned enough points to have translated and buy the coffee with points. Okay, that simple process is driving a registration process, a number of over 80% of people that buy cards give us their full registration details. Now, when you think in Hong Kong that we are the world's most impatient people, somebody who's paying 36 Hong Kong dollars for a cup of coffee, okay, that is a guy who does not fill out forms, okay, very typically. Now, we've got more than 80% of the people that take a card register, and I think it is currently, I haven't counted for a long time, we've been running this program for ages, but I think it's currently about 47 pieces of information that they collect.
But in a very initial stage, y'all had to sell a $200 top-up card or a card with a value.
Yep.
How did you go about doing that?
How do we sell that card?
To begin
because
with.
You're selling that card because you're getting value back from the program. Okay, so you're selling the program. Say, you join my program, I'm earning you points, which is going to get you free coffee. The free world is very important, pretty obviously. You're driving them into the program, and then you get them to register. And the trick is we get them in the program, and then we give them the carrot to actually go and register. Okay, it's been very, very effective. Anyway, I'm going to take too long if we keep going all these questions. Sorry. So the next level up as we start to move forward through this activity is to get into, you know, how do we start to look at the data? So obviously we're looking at data history, and then we start to get into the data analytics. Okay, so I'm just going to give a quick wave to Satya down at the front here. Okay, so Abiba, who's a Bangalore-based company, is our engine for all of the analytics work that we're doing. So if anything that I'm about to say probably quite quickly gets a little confusing, then grab Satya at the end or grab me at the end. Pretty obviously, we're using all sorts of analytics tools to try and drive that analysis and spot those trends. Once we've spotted the trend, what we're really looking for is what we call the insight. What is the revenue opportunity? What is going to actually bring me money? And the key to any engagement program, if it's not blindingly obvious, is money. It must be about money. There's so many people that we come across that want to have a loyalty program because they feel they need the word loyalty and the execution and everything else. If your loyalty program, your engagement program, is not about driving revenue, please, please do not do it. You're just adding cost. So we're looking for that revenue opportunity. The simple world, let's just talk a simple coffee chain example. If I come every morning, Monday to Friday, and buy a cup of coffee, can I give you 5, 6, 10 free donut coupons and train you into buying your own donut because you get used to having a donut with your coffee? If I do, I've driven your incremental revenue. Okay, so we're looking for those insights about revenue. Take out who the target is, but then start to look at for the influencers. There is no point giving me a cappuccino because I don't drink cappuccino. Okay, making sure, again, that we get the right influencer for the right customer to actually drive his behavior. What's the prize, the reward, or the incentive? Okay, so we need to then match those guys and communicate it. Again, as I was alluding to at the beginning, the communication channels by customer differ. Making sure that we get the right customer channel with the right reward and the right communication at the right time is very important. Okay, different people have a different threshold for how many messages that they can get. Obviously, what's the response? And that starts to drive into the analytics of the program and the ROI of the program. Have we actually got the result that we want? And not the result that we want today, but the result that we want in 3 months' time. Did I successfully change your behavior? Now, again, in the good old days of the army, you know, we had an expression that no plan survives contact with the enemy. And this is exactly the same. It doesn't matter what you think. The reality of the market is it will tell you what's right and what's wrong. It's no point guessing, it's in the data. So we get into this world of comparative analytics, this business intelligence world, and you're starting to drive into what can the program tell you, and how can you spot those opportunities. Now there's one world here that is you can spend days and days and days at a time blindly looking at different trends, different activities, what's happened in this store to that store, and just doing 1,001 different comparisons to try and spot a trend. But what we're really doing, as we'll look at the last little piece coming up in a second, is trying to spot some of those at a much higher level. So what the data tells you, some of this is not even customer related particularly. All we're looking at is, what are some of the obvious trends? And this is what I was talking about right at the beginning. If some of the opportunities are actually not that sophisticated. If I'm in the restaurant business, I've got people that come at lunch and I've got people that come at dinner. I've got people that come on at the weekends and people that come through the weekday. From an incremental revenue point of view, it is clear that if I can get a guy who's only ever visited me on a weekday to come at a weekend, I'm getting more money. If I can get a guy that comes for breakfast only, can I bring him later on in the day, and can I lure him into coming later on in the day and influence him so that he comes and spends more money with me? Okay, so this is all the world where I'm now no longer really talking about customer acquisition. I'm really now trying to drive about creating more value from my existing customers. Now, the way that we make sense of all of this, the big story that I've given you so far in terms of how do we do this, how do we do that, there's so much data that is available to us. it is almost impossible for you to make sense of it. What are the real opportunities? What is the low-hanging fruit? Okay, so some of the things that we do to try and mitigate this and bring it to a level that actually we can cope with the data and understand the data to see those opportunities lead us into this customer segmentation exercise. One of the fascinating things in this world of data analytics and everything else, if you look at the old Tesco club card program, they've been through a process where they've looked at literally hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of different segments, but ultimately brought it back into a much fewer number that they can cope with. Because again, you can't get to that level of personalization. You, the consumer, believe it's a personalized service, but in truth, from a data point, it's not. So what do? We look at the key variables in the business. What is driving the value in a restaurant, in an F&B, in a retail business? Pretty straightforward. How long have you been in the program? You must like me more if you've been in the program for a long time. And all of these programs have natural exit points if you're not spending and staying in the program. Recency, frequency, and obviously, much more importantly, how much are you spending? So what we look at doing, again, from a simplification point of view, is taking the data that we've got, clear out the outlying data that we don't really care about, and look at the meat of the data to try and define three bands of low, medium, and high. It's equally possible to have 20 bands, but I can't cope with 20 bands. I just can't see it and understand the data. So all we're doing, you know, in a recency, have you come? You haven't come within the last 3 months. You know, you've come in the last month. Pretty straightforward. You know, how much are you spending in the period that we're looking at? Maybe the last 6 months, the last year, whatever it happens to be. But it gives us something that we can intuitively understand and spot the opportunity. And you break down each customer by bands into what his score is, low, medium, and high, for the key four variables. And then you do some magic. And the magic is we start to run the business intelligence and the algorithms that Satya and his team at Abiba are giving us to identify a number of groups of customers that have similar traits. They're not all going to be exactly the same, but they have similar traits. And we can see that group that is from the algorithm segmented together and look at what those traits are in that simple low, medium, high world to say what we should be doing with them. Well, this is the most easiest example in the world. Obviously, the top-level customers, there's a small number of them, but they are your super fans. They love you. And so they're quite obviously come all of the time, high frequency, spending lots of money, and most of them have been your customers for some time. Okay? We love these guys. Very easy to spot, nothing to do with these guys apart from just give them that love so that they don't go somewhere else. If you lose these guys, your business goes off a cliff. This is all about retention and sustaining these guys and making sure that they feel the most important. If you take a second segment here, and this is what the data is telling us, that the second segment that we can clearly identify has been around for a long time. Their tenure down here in green is very high. Most of these guys have been with us for quite some time. But most worryingly is they haven't actually visited for a couple of months. If we don't bring these people back, they are gone. Now, if they've got this tenure, quite clearly, they like eating at our restaurant, drinking our drinks, whatever it happens is. They have an affinity to us, but we're in danger of losing them. Yeah. Pretty clearly, we want to bring those guys back. These guys are the switchers. They're off to Starbucks, somewhere like that. Over here, not high enough frequency, and their revenue in the period that we're looking at is low. But chances are, their revenue previously was much higher. Okay? Because if they haven't been in the last 3 months, and we're looking at 6 months worth of data, you know, inevitably, the total in 6 months will be lower. So these guys are well worth bringing back. And they're a big piece of the base. We really need to go after these guys very rapidly. But equally, because we've got the data, we can then start to run the analysis to the next level. If we can move 2% of these guys up the tree into that superstar level, that's an instant 5% increase in revenue. Now you can start to understand the effort and the reward that it's worth offering these guys to come back, because you can see and calculate what you're going to get out of it. Similar sort of level, these guys down here have come in fairly recently, but have a relatively short tenure. So these are newer customers. They've been around for 3, 6, 9 months. And they like us because they've been in. But because they're newer, they haven't yet really built that frequency. They haven't yet built that high level of revenue that we want. So again, it's blindingly clear from even this simple solution that we're really targeting these guys for frequency. Because if I can get them to come more frequently, I'm going to drive more revenue. But they're coming most recently anyway, so they're already in mind with us. And again, we can calculate what that means in terms of revenue opportunity. And therefore know what we should be spending about going after these people. The inactive customers are very simple, very straightforward. Just bring them back. You can see and understand what they used to be doing. A lot of them have got quite high tenure. You know, how do we get those guys back before it's too late? Okay. It's a very, very speedy run through. I think I've taken the time that I was asked to take. I think we've got 5 minutes if there are any additional questions. But do feel free to grab me or Satya, who's the very detailed expert in the analytics, if there's anything else you'd like to know. Any questions?
So consider an example that we do not have data about the customer. So we don't have targeted data about the customer. What kind of analysis can be done in that case? So in this example, all the 4 points are with respect to so frequency and tenure and all of it. When you know the customer, you can identify. But if you only have the example of the sales of the last 1 year, what kind of analysis can you do then?
Do you want to answer that? So in my world, where what I'm driving is for my client, who tends to be a retailer, you know, what I'm looking at is his member base, his loyalty program, and driving that program. So yes, clearly, I would prefer to have a communication channel. However, there's a world of analytics that's somewhat slightly different, which obviously looks at your full extent of your business. Typically, I would say that rather than customer, that's looking at product. But Satya, if you want to answer that.
Yeah. You saw that, you know, there was some analysis based on the time of the day, time of the month, type of product. So there are two types of analytics you can do. You can either do the segment level analytics, which is a little higher level, or you can go down to customer level. So when you don't have customer data, you can still do a lot of segment level analytics, which can be trends, which can be, you know, product affinity, what I call product affinity. You wouldn't know who that customer is. If somebody is buying chocolate, is he also having a soft drink? Right? That kind of affinity you could do with just transaction data, which are the invoice data or any of the standard transaction data you have.
Right. There's another one. So making the initial connect or registering them first or getting their initial info seems to be like the most hardest task. Are there any insights or tips that you can give about that?
Sorry, can you just repeat that? I was looking the wrong way.
So making the initial connect with the consumer or registering them initially, yeah. Or capturing their data once they come to your store seems to be like the hardest part to do.
Yes.
So do you have any insight or tips where how or different means that you can go about it?
So I tried to give two examples there. One way was the case study on KFC as a way to get people into the program. One was what I was explaining about the Pacific Coffee program. It is without doubt the hardest piece of the program, because we all know, and I'm the worst in the world, I just don't fill out forms. And what I would say is probably the key message I would give you is you must make it customer self-registration. Okay, and I'll give you an example. There's a name like Alistair, which may not be very well known to you guys. Where I come from in Scotland, there are probably 25 ways of spelling my Christian name. my handwriting is absolutely abysmal. It is very, very difficult for a brand to have a loyalty relationship with me if I filled out my form and they write to me as Dear Orster, because the L and the I they've put together into a big U, because they don't have any context to read that form. They're just doing data entry. As soon as I get that, I have no connection with that brand. Now, I know it's my fault because I've written badly and everything else, but the brand loses. So anything that is to do with bits of paper, handwriting, customers filling out forms, somebody completely different doing data entry will fail immediately. Anything that is the customer entering his own data will work, because I know what my name is, and if I mistype it, I know enough to correct it. Okay, so data accuracy on self-registration is critical. Okay, the other two comments that I gave in PCC and KFC is, you know, you're luring somebody in. You know, there's got to be bait. You know, there's got to be something that as a consumer I can see and understand what I'm getting out of it. Now, you're right, it's very difficult. As I'm launching a loyalty program or an engagement program in a consumer, I have, you know, 4, 5, 6 messages. One, that the program exists, what you do to get into it, what you're going to get when you get out of it, how important you are to me, all of these things. I have to get that message across. Well, when I grew up in the telecoms world, we lived by a message that was one ad, one message. Okay, but now I've got to have something that's given you 5 or 6 messages. It is incredibly complicated. So simplicity and getting the consumer to want to be in the program rather than trying to tell force the program on the consumer is critical. And in both cases, with the KFC example, that desire was because I wanted some freebies and all I had to do was click. So the effort was appropriate to the level of desire and reward. In Pacific Coffee, it's exactly the same thing. A lot of it is status. I want to be seen as being part of the team. I want that convenience, speed of transaction when I'm going up. When Starbucks launched the Starbucks card all of those years ago, it wasn't to be used as a gift for people to give to colleagues, anything else. The sole purpose of that Starbucks card was to shave 3 or 4 seconds off a transaction over cash. Because all you're doing is you're swiping and paying. It's much quicker than doing change and handling cash. That's why they did the Starbucks card. It was only later that they worked out, okay, well, it's the perfect gift to give somebody in the office and I can acquire a customer. But it was actually operational. Okay, so whilst the consumer sees the convenience doesn't sell. You've got to have some prize. And the way that you communicate that needs to be as simple as possible. So a program that starts with, join my program, be a gold, silver, bronze medal, and if you get a gold medal tier, then you're going to get this, a bronze, this, that. Consumer's gone. Join my program and do this. That's all you can cope with. Any more?
I had a small question on the previous one. The question was, supposing you do not have the data, would you still recommend, of a particular customer, would you still recommend any rewards for that particular customer?
Know the question or understand the question. I think the question is if I have a customer who I don't know who he is,
correct,
would I offer him rewards?
Correct, yeah.
Actually, what I would say is slightly different. I would offer him incentives. Okay? If I can't communicate with him to tell him what I want to do, and knowing your customer to me means having that communication channel. If I can't communicate with him to know what to do, then I'm struggling to tell him, do this and get that. What I can do is the other way around, and this is where Satya is going, and I'm saying, okay, now I'm looking at it, and I know that people that drink a lot of latte also like donuts, in principle, from my whole customer base. So now what I'm saying is anybody that wants to drink a latte will get a free donut, because I know that there's going to be so I'm incentivizing him to do something different. Okay, so it actually, you turn it slightly on its head, so I wouldn't use the word rewards. I would try to lead him down a path rather than rewarding him for going down a path. Does that make sense? Excuse me. Okay. Oh, sorry, one more.
Hello.
Hi.
Yeah, hi. Actually, we are coming up with a food business.
Yep.
Where we have developed our customer engagement program.
I didn't hear. Could somebody turn the mic on, please?
Yeah. We have developed a theme, how it should be implemented, where people want to come and register and have a loyalty program. We want to engage them.
Yep.
Can you guys customize it for according to our needs,
of course.
Loyalty program?
One of the things that, right at the beginning, one of the things that I would say is, you know, everything that you do in life is largely driven by an objective. And I'm absolutely convinced that the objective of your loyalty program would be slightly different from the objective of other people. Some people are using loyalty for acquisition. Some people are using loyalty for frequency. Some people are using loyalty for recency or retention, depending on your brand and your connection with your brand and your consumers. So every loyalty program that we do is customized to fit that business. And the whole setup of the exercise is us understanding your business, you understanding the capabilities, and we'll end up using 20-30% of the capabilities to do what we need to you. But it will be 20-30% that's different from the next person that we're dealing with. Okay, so almost by its nature, you know, engagement programs for a brand are unique every single time.
Okay, that's great.
There's no choice.
Okay, that's great.
Sorry? How does pricing work in loyalty? So there's no answer to that. It's this to this in terms of how sophisticated the program is. If the program is just get a guy in, send him an SMS, you know, from time to time, you know, it's not very sophisticated. If you get all the way into sort of customer segmentation using all of the analytics tool, it gets a lot more sophisticated. Some of the levers that we use, though, are, you know, clearly you're looking at number of customers in the program. Sometimes active or inactive customers are the drivers, you know, that we multiply out different fees. Sometimes you look at it at the spend under the program and take a percentage of that so that it's controlled. It depends on the retail category. In F&B, where quick service, where you want people coming every month, it might be per customer head. You know, not appropriate for this audience, but in fashion, when you're expecting somebody to come every 3 months, 6 months to your brand, then, you know, you don't want to be paying every month when he hasn't even turned up. So sometimes you do that slightly differently. So there's all sorts of levers that we use, and what we try to do is you start simply, because execution of this stuff at a store level, at a restaurant level, you know, is quite sophisticated, and then you start to grow the level of complexity over time. And as you grow the level of complexity, more money, pretty obvious. Good. Thank you very much indeed.